48 hours later, September 13th, an update. Private flights were still prohibited. To take off required government approval at the highest level. That morning, Prince Bandar of Saudi Arabia visited the White House. And later that day, something unusual began to happen. Despite the blanket aviation ban, several private planes, from Learjets to a 747, were cleared to depart from various U.S. cities. On board were dozens of the Saudi elite. Almost every one of Bin Laden or a Saudi royal. Meanwhile, Elizabeth Alderman was desperate to find a way from Paris to New York, where her son Peter was missing.
Bin Laden family, whoever was in the United States, got safe passage home. And I couldn't get home to be with my children. Other families couldn't get to New York, who lived far away, to even begin to look for their children. At this point, we didn't know who was alive or who was dead. I couldn't get home, and the Bin Laden family were all able to get home.
Since 15 of the 19 hijackers were accused of being Muslims from Saudi Arabia, why wasn't the fury of George W. Bush directed at Saudi Arabia instead of opium-rich Afghanistan and oil-rich Iraq? Before the first plane ever even hit the first tower on 911, a massive military buildup was organized near Afghanistan called Operation Swift Sword and Operation Bright Star. 23,000 British troops were sent to the Oman Gulf near Afghanistan, and 17,000 U.S. troops joined NATO troops in nearby Egypt. All of these forces were positioned for attacks on the Muslim countries of Afghanistan and Iraq before 911. The Patriot Act, which was designed to limit American citizens' democratic rights and freedoms, was also designed and written months before the first plane ever even hit the first tower. So who exactly are the producers of the 911 reality disaster movie that collected billions from insider stock market trades, $200 billion and counting from terrorized U.S. taxpayers, and gazillions of dollars from the conquest of Iraq's oil fields and Afghanistan's opium fields? Contrary to popular opinion, the producers of 911 are not practicing Jews. And contrary to popular opinion, the producers of 911 are not practicing Muslims.
Hello.
They are a secret network of international pirates who identify with no nation, no national flag, and no established religion. Their flag is the skull and crossbones, and their god, G-O-D, spells gold, oil, and drugs.
March 13th, 1962. Lyman Lemnitzer, Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, presents a proposal to Secretary of Defense Robert McNamara named Operation Northwoods. The document proposed staging terrorist attacks in and around Guantanamo Bay to provide a pretext for military intervention in Cuba. The plans included starting rumors about Cuba using clandestine radio, landing friendly Cubans inside the base to stage attacks, starting riots at the main gate, blowing up ammunition inside the base, starting fires, sabotaging aircraft and ships on the base, bombing the base with mortar shells, sinking a ship outside the entrance, staging funerals for mock victims, staging a terror campaign in Miami, Florida and Washington, D.C., and finally, destroying a drone aircraft over Cuban waters. The passengers, federal agents in reality, would allegedly be college students on vacation. A plane at Eglin Air Force Base would be painted and numbered as a duplicate of a registered civil aircraft belonging to a CIA front in Miami. The duplicate would be substituted for the real plane and loaded with the passengers. The real plane would be converted into a drone. The two planes would rendezvous south of Florida. The passenger-laden plane would land at Eglin Air Force Base to evacuate its passengers and return to its original status. The drone would pick up the scheduled flight plan and, over Cuban waters, transmit a Mayday signal before being blown up by remote control. The plan is rejected by McNamara, and President John F. Kennedy personally removes Lemnitzer as chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. December 1st, 1984. A remote-controlled Boeing 720 takes off from Edwards Air Force Base and is crash-landed by NASA for fuel research. Before its destruction, the plane flew a total of 16 hours and 22 minutes, including 10 takeoffs, 69 approaches, and 13 landings. August 1997. The cover of FEMA's Emergency Response to Terrorism depicts the World Trade Center in crosshairs. February 28, 1998. The Global Hawk, Raytheon's unmanned aircraft vehicle, completes its first flight over Edwards Air Force Base in California at an altitude of 32,000 feet, cruising altitude for a commercial jetliner. 1999. NORAD begins conducting exercises in which hijacked airliners are flown into the World Trade Center and the Pentagon. June 2000. The Department of Justice releases a terrorism manual with the World Trade Center in crosshairs. September 2000. The Project for a New American Century, a neoconservative think tank whose members include Dick Cheney, Donald Rumsfeld, Jeb Bush, and Paul Wolfowitz, releases their report entitled Rebuilding America's Defenses. In it, they declare that the process of transformation, even if it brings revolutionary change, is likely to be a long one, absent some catastrophic and catalyzing event, like a new Pearl Harbor. October 24, 2000. The Pentagon conducts the first of two training exercises called Mascow, which simulate a Boeing 757 crashing into the building. Charles Burlingame, an ex-Navy F-4 pilot who worked in the Pentagon, participates in this exercise before retiring to take a job at American Airlines, where, less than a year later, his Boeing 757 allegedly crashes into the building. April 2001. NORAD plans an exercise in which a plane is flown into the Pentagon, but is rejected as too unrealistic. June 2001. The Department of Defense initiates new instructions for military intervention in the case of a hijacking. It states that for all non-immediate responses, the Department of Defense must get permission directly from the Secretary of Defense. Attorney General John Ashcroft begins flying on chartered jets for the remainder of his term due to a threat assessment by the FBI. July 4th, 2001. Osama bin Laden, wanted by the United States since 1998, receives medical attention at the American Hospital in Dubai, where he is visited by a local chief of the CIA. July 24th, 2001. Larry A. Silverstein, who already owned World Trade Center 7, signs a $3.2 billion, 99-year lease on the entire World Trade Center complex 6 weeks before 9/11. Included in the lease is a $3.5 billion insurance policy, specifically covering acts of terrorism. September 6, 2001, 3,150 put options are placed on United Airlines stock. A put option is a bet that a stock will fall. That day, put options were more than four times its daily average. Bomb-sniffing dogs are pulled from the World Trade Center, and security guards end 2 weeks of 12-hour shifts. September 7, 2001. 27,294 put options are placed on Boeing stock, more than five times the daily average. September 10, 2001. 4,516 put options are placed on American Airlines, almost 11 times its daily average. Newsweek reports that a number of top Pentagon brass canceled their flight plans for the next morning. San Francisco Mayor Willie Brown receives a phone call warning him not to fly the next morning. Pacifica Radio later reveals that this phone call came directly from National Security Advisor Condoleezza Rice. And in Pakistan, at a military hospital, all of the urologists are replaced by a special team in order to host their guest of honor, Osama bin Laden, who is carefully escorted inside to be watched carefully and looked after.